Morning, friends. Let's complete the exercise 1.2 and the next exercise 1.3. So we are starting with exercise 1.2 from question number 4. I explained you up to the question number 3 and now the question number 4, in which it is given that the LCM of two numbers is 9. So we will say actually the two numbers are 306 and 657. These are the two numbers and they have their LCF as a 9. So LCF of the number is 9. They have to find the LCM of the number. Now you will use the formula. You will use the formula that is LCF multiply LCM is equal to the product of the number. We have verified this formula in question 2. So we can use this formula. We can say that LCF multiply LCM is equal to product of number. Now you can put values of LCM and the numbers like HCF and the number. We get the value of we have the value of HCF that is 9 and we don't know the value of LCM, so I'm writing it like LCM and the product of the two numbers are 306 and 657. Now we can rearrange the equation. So LCM will be equal to 306 multiplied with the 657 divided by 9. Now you can cancel any the number by 9. 9 3 is 27 or 9 4 is 36. Now you can multiply 657 with the 34 to get your final answer, to get the value of LCM. So I think you can do yourself. So you can multiply 34 with the 657 to find out the value of LCM. So this is the question number, not the one, it is fourth question. Okay, next the question number fifth. Next question is question number fifth. Okay, in question number fifth, it's actually a statement based question. But first you should try to understand what is the meaning of the question and how can you prove it. And then you can easily even write a statement yourself. Like check whether 6 is to power n can end with the digit 0 for any natural number. So you have to prove it 6 is to power n, where n can be any natural number. So according to question, 8 number cannot be end with the digit 0. Let's talk about the number which having the unit digit at 0, like 10, 20, 30, any of the bigger number. So what is the common things about these numbers? They can be divisible by 10, obviously, and 10 means they can be divisible by 2 as well as 5. It means the numbers which have 0 at their unit place should be divisible by 2 as well as 5. Because 2 5s are 10, so then they will have the 0 at the unit place. So you can say if a number is end with the digit 0, it means it should be divisible by 2 as well as 5. Now in this question, that is, you have to prove that 6 to the power n can end with the digit 0. So you will say if the number is end with the digit 0, it should be divisible by 2 as well as 5. And if you make the factor of number 6, it will be 2 into 3, 2 3s are 6. It don't have the value of, it don't have the factor as a 5. Since this number do not have the factor as a 5, so we will say it cannot be end with the digit 0. So actually this is a very, it's so easy question. Or first of all, you should understand what is the meaning of this question and how can you prove it. And then you can write the statement for all this, for this question. Question is, you have to prove that 6 to the power n can end with the digit 0. So you will say 6 is to power n. If 6 is to power n is end with the digit 0, is ends with digit 0, that it should has 5 as a factor. It would have 5 as factor. 5 is a prime number. We can't say 0, 10 is a factor because 10 is not the prime number. So we are talking about the prime factors, prime numbers. So it means it should have 5 as a factor. Now the prime factorization of 6 to the power n. Prime factors of 6 to the power n is equal to 2 3s are 6 is to the power n, or we can say 2 is to the power n into 3 is to the power n. So in these factors of 6, we don't have a number that is 5, a prime number 5. So we can say, now the fundamental theorem of arithmetic guarantee that if this number cannot have any other primes other than 2 and 3. So we also write this statement here. So it means this number cannot have other factor other than 2 and 3. So we can say since 5 is not the factor of this number, so it cannot be under the result 0. Now I am going to write it on this board. So the uniqueness of fundamental theorem of arithmetic guarantee that there are no any other prime in factorization of 6 to the power n. It means it has only the two factors, two prime factors, that is 2 and 3. Not other than any other number other than 2 and 3 can be there in this 6 to the power n, because this statement does. This number has only 2 and 3 as a prime factors. This statement is guaranteed by fundamental theorem of arithmetic. So now we will write it. So initially we have written that for if this number and the digit 0, then it should have the prime as a 5 as a factor. Now we proved that this number do not have 5 as a factor, so we can say, so 6 to the power n cannot be and with digit 0. So actually this is a very statement based question. But after understanding how can we, what is the meaning of the question, how can we solve it, it's become easy to write the statement here like this. So now the next question, question number 5. Yes. Sorry, 6th question. This was the question number 5. I am going to explain the next question, question number 6. This was the question number 5. Question number 6. Explain why this and this are the composite numbers. Okay. First you should know what are the composite in the whiteboard, are the prime factors, prime numbers, sorry. You have learned about the composite and the prime numbers in lower classes, like in class, I think class 4th, 5th or 6th. So what are the composite and what are the prime numbers? First the prime numbers. Prime numbers are those which has only one and the number itself as a factor, like 11. 11 has a factor 11 and 1. And 13 has a factor 1 and 13. So these are the prime numbers. Prime numbers are those which has 1 and that number as a prime number, as a prime factors. And composite number has more than two factors. It means other than 1 and that number itself, it has other factors also. So the composite number, the numbers which are not the prime numbers are actually the composite number. So you can say that composite number are those which has more than two factors. It means 1 and the number itself, and other than these two numbers, It has also other factors. So these numbers are called the composite number. In question number 6, explain why 7 into 11 into 13 plus 13. So first 7 into 11 into 13 plus 13. You have to put this is a composite number. So I am taking one question, one part of the question. We can take 13 as a common here. So I am taking 13 as a common. It will be 7 into 11 plus 1. Now can we solve it? Yes. 7 11 jar 27 plus 1, it will be 78. So you will say this number has more than two factors, that is 1, 13, 78. It means this number is divisible by more than two numbers, that is 1, 13, 78, and also write again that number, that is what is the number? Okay, whatever it is. So 1, 13, and 78. It has more than two factors. Since this number has more than two factors, again we can factorize the 78 also, but it's not necessary here because you need to prove only that this number has only more than two factors. So more than two means it can be 3 or it can be more than 3. So it doesn't matter if you are factorizing this 78 or not. Karte bhi ho to bhi sahi. So now this number has more than two factors, that is this, this and this. So it is a composite number. And the second part of the question you can prove like this, in which you have to prove 6 into 7 into 6 into 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1 plus 5. So here in this part you will take 5 as a common and you will show that it has more than two factors, that is 1, 5 and the number which was there in the bracket. So which would be there in the bracket, so you can say that since it has more than two factors, so this is a composite number. This was the question number 6. Easy questions? Okay. Now I will explain you question number 7. There is a circular path around a sports field. So this is a circular path. Sonia takes 18 meter drive one round to the field. So Sonia starts from this point and it takes 18 minutes to drive on the circular path. While Ravi takes 12 minutes for the same, and Ravi take 12 minutes to complete one round of the circular path. Suppose they both start at the same point and at the same time. So both of them, Sonia and Ravi, start from the same point, that is the point A, at the same time and go in the same direction. And suppose they are going in the same direction. After how many minutes will they meet again at the starting point? Now, according to question, after how many minutes they will meet again? So just imagine. Sonia is taking 18 minutes to complete a round. Ravi takes 12 minutes to complete a round. So is it possible that they meet before 18 or 12 minutes? Is it? Just think about this question. Suppose two friends are moving in a circular path, or one of them taking 18 minutes for completing the round and other one is taking 12 minutes. So it means they will meet again at this point. This number, this time will be more than 12 in the 18 minutes. It can't be possible that they meet again before 18 or 12 minutes. It means the number should be the multiple of these two numbers. The number is 100% larger than 18 and 12 minutes. So it means it should be the multiple of the same numbers. It should be the multiple of 18 and 12. So multiple and the least common multiple, it means the lowest term which is a common for both the terms, lowest number which is common for both the number, we can say the least common multiple. So it means in this case we have to find the least common multiple, that is the LCM of the number 18 and 12. So you will get the LCM of 18 and 12 for finding when they will meet again at the starting point. So it's important to understand the question, how can you solve it, and I think it's not hard to solve this question. Okay, you have to find out the LCM of this question. Now I'm going to explain to you the next exercise, irrational number. Yes, this is a really important exercise. From this exercise we get 3 marks questions in board exams. Next exercise, exercise 1.3.
Yes.
In this exercise, first you should know what are the rational and irrational numbers. In class 9, you have learned about the rational and irrational number. Rational numbers are those which can be represented in the form of P upon Q. I think it should be remembered that what is the rational number and what are the irrational number. So, rational numbers are those which can be represented in the form of P upon Q. And the irrational number are those which can't be represented in the form of P upon Q. And the important condition for P upon Q is the P and Q should be the co-prime numbers and Q should not be equal to 0. So first you should know what is the rational number. So in this exercise we have to prove either root 2 is a irrational number, root 3 is a irrational number, like this. So first I am going to explain you how we prove that under root 2 is a irrational number, or under root 3 is a irrational number, or under root 5 is an irrational number. So I am taking one of the example, like I am going to prove under root 3 is an irrational number. Okay. So you have to prove, question is prove that under root 3 is an irrational number. This is not the question from your book. It was under root 5. So you will do yourself under root 5. So I am going to prove under root 3 is an irrational number. So we solve this question by using the contradiction method. So in contradiction method, we suppose that we have to prove it is an irrational number, and we will suppose that it is a rational number. And if it is a rational number, then it will satisfy all the condition of the rational number. So we will use a contradiction method. This is called the contradiction method. So we suppose, so take let's under root 3 is a rational number. This chapter basically, whole chapter is statement based question. So you should practice, you have to practice of writing the statement for every question. Like let under root 3 is a rational number. So we are taking that this is a rational number. And what is the condition for rational number? We will say that it can be represented in the form of P upon Q. So we will write here, so under root 3 is equal to, I am taking A upon B. It can be A upon B, it can be R upon S, it can be P upon Q. So now this statement which we are, which I am going to write it in the brackets, is really important. Now under root 3 is A upon B, is equal to A upon B. We say that rational number can be represented in the form of P upon Q. Now the important condition is A and B are co-prime number. It's very important to write this statement. Co-prime is both the number has only one as a common factor, not other than one. They are the co-prime number. So we can say that A and B do not have any common factor other than one, and B should not equal to 0. This is a very important statement, and you have to write it in a bracket that A and B are the co-prime number and B is not equal to 0. Now we are rearranging the terms, like by cross multiplication of B with the under root 3, we will get under root 3 B is equal to A. Okay. Now we know that square of a rational number is also a rational number. So we can say squaring on both sides. Squaring on both side. So you can also write here the square of a rational number is also a rational number. Okay, you can write the statement here, the square of a rational number is also a rational number. Now by squaring we will get 3b square is equal to a square. And now we can say that this is a theorem 1.3 of Edgar NCERT book. According to the theorem, if any number is a factor of any square number, like I am saying that 36 having the factor 2. Yes?
Yeah.
So it means 2 can divide 36. Then what is the square root of 36? It is 6. So 6 should also be divisible by 2. So this is the theorem 1.3. Ki if a number divides the square number, it will also divide the square root of that number. So we will use the theorem 1.3 here in this question. Like according to, we don't need to write according to the theorem 1.3. We will write it 3 divides a square. So three will also divide P. Is it clear? Just like 2 can divide 36, we will also divide the square root of 36, that is 6. So I'm writing here 3 divides A square, so 3 will also divide A. Again, if I'm saying that 2 can divide 6, so I can write it in the form of 2 into 3. It means if a number can divide another number, so we can write the number in this form. Like suppose I'm taking large number. Like 81. So we know that 3 can divide 81. So can we write it in the form of 3 into 27? Yes. So it means I am saying that if 3 can divide A, so we can say that suppose A is equal to 3m. Okay. If 3 can divide A, it means we can write A in the terms of 3. 3 multiplied with an integer. So you will write here where m is an integer. Okay. So first, what will we do? We will do root 3 is a upon b. Is equal to a upon b. Since it is a rational number, so we can represent in the form of a upon b. Where a and b are the programming number and b is not equal to 0. It's very important to write this statement, otherwise the number half or the 1 marks can be detected from your marks. You are not writing these statements like in brackets. So under root 3b is equal to a by rearranging the terms. So by squaring both the terms, we can say the square of a rational number is also a rational number. So 3b square is equal to a square. Now we will use the theorem 1.3 of NCERT book. We will say that 3 divides a square. So 3 will also divide a. Now, let's suppose A is equal to 3m. Okay? If a number can divide another number, it means we can represent this another number in the form of the first number. So, we are writing A is equal to 3m, where m is an integer. So, this is equation 1. Now, put the value of A in equation 1 by putting value of A in equation 1. So I am going to put the value of A in equation 1. It is 3b square is equal to 3m square. It will be 3b square is equal to 9m square. And by dividing 3 on both the side, by dividing by 3 on both the side, we will get b square is equal to 3m square. Is it?
Yes.
Now we will say 3 can divide b square. So according to theorem 1.3, we can say that 3 will also divide b. So we have to write this statement here. 3 divides b square. So 3 will also divide b. Now, we told that a and b are the co-prime number. It means they do not have any other common factor other than 1. So now we have proved that 3 can divide A and 3 can also divide B. It means that A and B have the common factor 3 according to us, like this. So it contradicts the fact that A and B are the co-prime number. It means our supposition is wrong and we can say that under root 3 is an irrational number. So this is called the contradiction method. So for writing statement, I have to rub the board now. So, you will say, we proved that 3 can divide A and 3 can also divide B. The meaning is, so, 3 can divide A and B. But, this contradicts the fact that A and B do not have any common factor. We show that A and B are co-prime numbers, they do not have any common factor. But now we have proved that 3 is a factor of A and 3 is also the factor of B. So this contradicts the fact that A and B are the co-prime numbers. A and B are the do not have any common factor. So our supposition is wrong. That is, our assumption is wrong, and under root 3 is an irrational number. So this is totally a statement based question, but by doing most of the questions, like you will prove under root 2 is an irrational number, now you will prove under root 5 is an irrational number. So by doing these questions, it will appear easy to you that these questions are not typical, but you need a practice for doing such questions. So these questions are of 3 marks. So now I'm going to explain you exercise 1.3. Okay, first you will prove that under root 2 is an irrational number and under root 5 is an irrational number. Okay. So this question you will do yourself. Now the next question is prove that 3 plus 2 root 5 is an irrational number. In class 9, I don't know whether you have learned or not that the sum of the irrational number can be a rational or can be irrational number. So now we have two numbers, that is 3 plus 2 root 5. This is the question number 2 of exercise 1.3. 3 plus 2 root 5. You have to prove that this is an irrational number. So by only saying that the 5 is an irrational number, you can't say that this will be a irrational number, because the sum of our irrational number can also be the rational or the irrational. So for proving this question, this type of question, first of all you will say that, again the contradiction method, you will say that let this is a rational number. And we know that we can write the rational number in the form of P upon Q. So 3 plus 2 root 5 is equal to, I am writing here P upon Q. It can be P upon Q, can be R upon S, can be A upon B, doesn't matter. But the important condition is P and Q are co-prime numbers. And Q is not equal to 0. So it's a very important condition that you have to write in the bracket. Now, by rearranging the terms, so we can see by separating 3 from both the sides, we know that the difference of a rational number is also a rational number. So by separating 3 from both the sides, we can see by rearranging the terms, we will get, actually what we are doing now, we will make this root 5 alone. Isko hum akela karne wale, iske saath ke jitne numbers hai sabko dusri side pahunchate hain. So by separating 3 from both the sides, you will say 2 root 5 is equal to P upon Q minus 3 will be is a rational number, because the difference of a rational number is also a rational number. Now by dividing both the sides by 2, under root 5 is equal to 1 upon 2 P upon Q minus 3 is a rational number. Again it should be a rational number, because the quotient of a rational number is also a rational number. So now we are dividing the terms by the rational number, that is 2. So this should be the also rational number. But here under root 5 is an irrational number. So we write here, but we know that under root 5 is an irrational number. Again, you have to prove that under root 5 is an irrational number. If this is not given in the question that under root 5 is an irrational number, then first you will prove that under root 5 is an irrational number. Like I explained you in the first part, that is under root 3 is an irrational number. I proved that under root 3 is an irrational number. So with the same way, you will prove that under root 5 is an irrational number, and then you will do this question like this. You will complete this question like this. So again, now we will write it. We know that under root 5 is an irrational number, Again, I'm telling you, if it is not given in the question that under root 5 is an irrational number, then first you will prove that under root 5 is an irrational number. Okay? So first you will prove that under root 5 is an irrational number. So we know that under 5 is an irrational number. So our assumption is wrong. Our assumption is wrong. And 3 plus 2 root 5 is a irrational number. Now again it's clear. This question always there in board exam in 3 marks. So again I'm telling you, if it's not given the question that under root 5 is an irrational number, then first you will prove that under root 5 is an irrational number, and then you will do this question like this, and then you will prove this question like this. Okay, so this was the question number 2nd. Again the third question is same. So I think you can do yourself, or in case of doubt you can ask me in Zoom class. So okay, let's continue with exercise 1.4 in next video. Okay, bye.